Hello and welcome to the program. Thank you so much for tuning in today. I'm your host, Neal Howard, on Health Professional Radio. You know, it may take years for a new medication to get approved by the U.S. Food and Drug Administration. In fact, many promising treatments fail to clear the FDA hurdle at all. And for some patients, access to approved treatments can literally be a matter of life and death. Joining us now to discuss the FDA approval process and its impact on a group of children with a rare and fatal disease is Dr. Jonathan Strober and Julia Cosgrove Garcia. Welcome to the program, both of you, Dr. Strober and Julia.
Thank you.
Dr. Strober, thank you for coming. Why is it so difficult for a new treatment to pass FDA approval?
Well, the FDA is looking for us to collect information to prove that a drug is both safe for patients to get, as well as that will benefit the patient. To do that, we have to run these clinical trials, which take years to collect the data that we need, which turns into millions and millions of dollars to run just one study. And then we also have to find the patients that we can enroll in these studies. And when we're talking about Duchenne muscular dystrophy, which affects less than 10,000 people in the country, it's often hard to find the patients that we need that fit the criteria for the clinical trials, that can travel to clinical trial sites, and also who are interested in being part of clinical trials, because it's not for everybody.
What happens if a drug can't get reviewed or get a complete look?
Well, I mean, if the FDA won't approve it or won't even take a look at the data, sometimes the companies can go back and try and collect more data, which requires more money, finding more patients, because you can't use the patients that have already been in the clinical trials, and the resources that you need to kind of continue on with these clinical trials can be really difficult. And so sometimes it's just ended for the drug, if that's the case.
Is this case for many rare diseases, or is this something that's unique to Duchenne muscular dystrophy?
No, this is something that's going on for a lot of rare diseases. With trying to find the patients that you can put into the trial, it can be very difficult and very costly.
Now, Julia, what's your story? How did it unfold, his diagnosis and whatnot?
Nick is 25 years old, and he has Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Duchenne is a progression of muscle wasting. The heart and the lungs are affected, as well as the bones are affected by the muscles wasting. And he was losing the ability to walk between 8 and 10 years of age. And just to give you an idea of how it does progress, is by the time that they're 25, most no longer can turn themselves in bed or can't even raise their hand. They require 24 hours, 7 days a week care. So it's emotionally and financially devastating. It's a catastrophic illness for families like mine.
Does the FDA take into consideration the magnitude of what your son is going through?
The FDA, as far as consideration for rare diseases such as my son does have, that's one of the things that we need, is for them to have leniency for rare disease, so that when these drugs do come into showing benefit, that they will look at it and let the patients have a voice in terms of getting that drug out there. Because what happens, they go into clinical trial, there's a lot that goes in the process, as Dr. Strober has said. And the FDA wants the data in a certain format. If it doesn't meet that data is at risk of being discontinued, even if this drug shows its benefit at them. So these patients in clinical trials lose out on that chance for a drug that does benefit them, which means others who can benefit from this drug lose out on that opportunity. So the ask is to keep the data. If it's showing benefit, let's keep the data and not throw it out, because too much has went in, and there's a lot of sacrifices that go in to families and patients to participate in the clinical trial. And also, again, leniency for rare disease and let the patients have a voice.
So how do you cope as this process takes place? How do you keep hope alive and go on with this awareness movement?
Keeping hope alive is very difficult at times. It's heartbreaking when this is going on. And if it does happen where the FDA is reviewing the data and it isn't what they're looking for, that's where families have a chance to join with organizations. I'm very involved with parentprojectmd.org, And they have helped us to have a voice and to reach out, contact Congress, contact your senators, anyone out there that can help, so that if they say this drug isn't meeting the format that we want it, that we use our voices to say, but it is showing it is working in a different area. We need to keep this drug.
And Dr. Strober, as far as the healthcare community is concerned, what can physicians do in order to get more awareness out?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, getting the word out there, talking to people, letting, you know, the patients, finding ways for the patients to get their voices, supporting these organizations such as the Muscular Dystrophy Association, Parent Project Muscular Dystrophy. There are so many of these parent-run organizations now, which is just awesome, not just for advocacy, but also to help support these patients through this difficult time.
Well, thank you both for talking with us today. I appreciate your time. Dr. Jonathan Strober, professor of neurology and pediatrics at UCSF, and also joining Dr. Strober is Julia Cosgrove Garcia, whose son is dealing with Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Thank you both for coming in.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Transcripts and audio of this program are available at healthprofessionalradio.com.au and also at hpr.fm. You can subscribe to this podcast on iTunes, listen in, and download at SoundCloud. And be sure and visit our affiliates page when you visit us at hpr.fm and healthprofessionalradio.com.au.